There I am, right there. What's up? How are you doing, man?
Hold on a second. It made me laugh because I was the only one on there. I'm like, something's not up here. Something's wrong.
Here we go. I don't know if you want to be used tonight or not. That's just where I'm at right now.
That's
go back smaller, but every once in a while to make a point, we must go, bam.
Okay.
Like that. We'll do that. We had three people, then we started and had one. So why would you watch it for a second and go, I'm not watching that? I mean, don't even watch it. I get it. I don't know. With that.
What's going on, man?
How are you doing?
Whew. It's been a good day. Got a little red today. Got out in the desert and had some snake encounters and stuff. I threw that sucker on TikTok just for fun because it's during the day. Keep something up. You put all this time and all this effort into putting out my last two. Traveled to Globe, you know. One got 6,000. One's got like 1,500 views. I put that thing out there 30 minutes ago. It's got 2,700 views.
That's good.
Yeah, it's good, but it's not. That's not that's a goofy little thing that if that's what people want to see, I'd go out there and do snake encounters all day long. But to get out there to dig a story up in a cemetery for 2 hours searching for a grave and only get 6,000 hits on it, I don't know.
Well, you just never know. I wondered who would come on today. That's why I decided, you know, regardless, this I'm not going to go put live. As soon as we get done, I'm going to turn it around and just put it back out again as a video and not a live. So hopefully it can gain a little traction there. And I thought, you know what? I was either going to do an e-bike thing or it's like, if Dean's available, let's just talk some history. You know, I always seemed like I got to have some type of intro, even though this is definitely not Lost Highway, but I always feel like you got to get started with something. So, you know, and I thought so many times that we talk on the phone, it'd be interesting to let people in on those privileges, those conversations, right? Yeah, I mean, you know, there's some stuff we talk about, things probably we wouldn't talk about live, but you know, maybe not. I mean, most of the stuff we talk about is pretty straight up. I mean, there's no like, you know, hidden agendas or hidden messages, but I thought, you know what, why not let people in on a conversation? It's kind of a private conversation. So you're kind of eavesdropping, but you're kind of not, right? I mean, you're kind of going, yeah.
If nobody's watching, it's a private conversation.
Well, you know, that's true too. And I, you know, that's the thing about it. I didn't care. I mean, I didn't put it out so people would know for 2 hours that we were going to be on. They're either going to get it or they're not. And then if they want to watch it later, that's great too. But that really wasn't as important as just the fact that, you know, where'd you go today? Let's start there. Where were you at today?
I went to South Mountain Park for the first time in 3 years. It always seems like I was just out there when I get there, but I went to Pima Canyon Trail to do some TikToks of some phenomenal petroglyphs, because I believe that trail has probably three of the best I've seen in Arizona. You know, outside of, again, my favorite place being Sears Point, that place has a lot of great petroglyphs. So I was like, let's go out, do a TikTok. A lot of people want to know where these things are at. I'm going to show you where they're at. Now, I'm not going to take you, you know, step by baby step all the way there, but I'm going to tell you what trail you need to be on and what you need to be looking out for. And then you can do the investigation when you get out there to find them. But I'm going to lead you right to these petroglyphs. But That was my focus today. It was 104 degrees out there today. I realize I'm an old man. Both my knees were hurting. I'm definitely out of shape. And South Mountain Park is probably off my radar from now on.
Well, you know, it was only what? How was it today?
When I left there, it was 104.
There's snow flame. Hi, snow flame. I don't know snow flame. Oh, look, it's got a lizard smoking a cigarette. I'm smoking a cigarette. That's pretty. I like that. I like that. Yeah. Thank you. Welcome. I'm glad you're here. And there is Don Barry. I am not here.
You know Don Barry.
I was never here. And if I was, I'll deny. And, you know, that'd be probably the best for your reputation, Don, that if you just said that I wasn't here. And, you know, I wouldn't be mad at you. So there's a special kind of weird thing where you were at, right? There's a weird history thing where you are at today. AH is here. What was it?
I will say what it is. You can kind of jump in and discuss the whole, because I don't really know the whole story all too well. Just glimpsed over it again after we got done talking earlier. And then my son, of course, had to watch Diamondbacks game, so I had to be out there. You know, it is interesting. When I was out there for the first time about 5 years ago, and somewhere around August of 2017 when I started this YouTube thing, South Mountain Park was my first spot. And so I really didn't know what I was doing. So I just started getting on these trails, and I came across something that was weird. It was a caged in, what we would call a petroglyph, but it wasn't the kind of petroglyphs that we are looking for. These ancient petroglyphs, they're dated around 11, 12, 1300 AD. It was a more recent, petroglyph, a more recent name put in the rock there. And, the reason it was crazy, and I walked by it, I remember taking a picture of it, not understanding why it was there, but it's, you know, it's this, I don't know if you have a picture of it. I should have sent you a picture of it. It's caged in with these unbelievable iron bars to protect the name that's on the rock. And I'll let you take it from there.
Well, who is it? You got me at the edge of my seat.
Well, now I can't. The reason I said that is because his name just flipped out of my head, and I'm going to have to bring it up on my camera thing.
Let me get in here and get into,
that's why I know I'm old, Jeff.
Niza. Let me look him up. Marcus Denizo, let's get him into, I got to figure out how to do this. Cause the one thing about today is this, even if I stumble around, I'm not going to worry about it. And if we need to do research on this show today, we're going to do the research as well. Yeah. And so there's no reason we can't get in here, and there's Chrome tab share. Come on. It won't let me do it. Come on. Give me the entire screen. Give me the window. Maybe I don't want to share. Maybe that's not what I want to do. Yeah, that's exactly
right. I can go like this. There's the picture of it.
Let me get out of this and get into, I've got to open a window up here. That's what's going on. I've got to open a window, and I don't know if.
Marco Denizza.
Yeah, I'm looking. Marco, I was going to look it up and see
here. I can share some pictures while you're looking that up. That's what's etched in the rock right there.
And like I said, I don't know if you can see me or not, but what I can do now is I can go back in. Now that I got that loaded, I can share my screen, get in here and look up this. And here is the petroglyph.
There we go. Perfect.
Right there.
There you go.
Niza, right there. That is the petroglyph that's in South Mountain that is supposed to be the infamous, explorer. I guess you call him, the infamous. Yeah. Marcos Niza.
You know what? You can really see that really good. You can't see that good today. You can't see, like, that says 1539 etched in there, right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, you can't. When I was on there, I've taken a picture. I got him sitting right here on the phone. That's very hard to see anymore. Like I was saying earlier, that part is in the sunshine a lot. Marco's name is not in the sunshine anymore, so it's really well protected.
Well, and you know, so the story goes that in what, about 1920s, a gentleman came to the state and told them that he found this famous pictograph of a famous Spanish explorer that really wasn't known to even have gone through here, and that this was unbelievable. So the city actually put those barriers up. And, you know, I've looked at a lot of petroglyphs in my life, Dean, and I've never seen a petroglyph with a cage around it.
Yeah. You would think one of our favorite people at the archaeology place would do that to some of their sites, the way they don't want nobody looking at what they got out there. And I find that absolutely amazing that is the etched in rock that's actually, you know, the barred in. I mean, if you look at those bars, that's heavy duty stuff. And to put it in the rock and the way they did it, that I don't care when they did that. That cost them thousands and thousands of dollars to put that in there.
So you can't see it in this one. Yeah. Let's see if I can get another one. See if let me go back and let me get in here and see. Here it is right here. So this is the barbed wire. Look at this.
Yeah, there it is.
A caged baboon behind there. You see the petroglyph right in there. But look at that cage. That's like pretty unbelievable.
I mean, it is like you're putting an animal that you're protecting some kind of species up there from coming out. And you can see the top. I don't know when that picture was taken, but that's about what it is now. Somebody took some unbelievable sledgehammer or something and tried their best to knock out one of those on the top. And they've actually gone in there because there's an updated like black bar now that's across there. So when somebody did that, when somebody smashed the one bar and they couldn't reach in to do anything to the signature or the writing on any of that rock there. And it doesn't stop people from doing other kind of damage to it because it's opened. But they went ahead in there and they put a black bar across where the other bar was at. So they went back and made sure that it was secured. So to this day, whether people believe it to be true or not, they're doing their best to protect that signature on that rock there.
Well, what I learned was that gentleman in front of the petroglyph right there, he did the research to see if that was real or not. And so he did the research, and it's on PBS, and it's really pretty cool because it goes back to them hunting for the lost cities of Cibola. The Spanish had just, in that era, had just taken Mexico City or Mexico. In Mexico had got all the gold out of Mexico, so they were gold hungry, and so they were told if they went north, they would find more gold. So the Spanish moved on forward. And so the story is that Niza, he was hunting for this gold. He was also hunting to save souls as well. He had a dual mission. And that maybe instead of going more northern towards New Mexico, he somehow stumbled into Phoenix, Arizona, which could be realistic in itself. But they actually cut those bars, got inside that cage, and did a process to see how old the petroglyphs were. So, and it was pretty interesting. And it's on PBS. There is a story about it. A gentleman that I know named Aaron, who wrote a book about the ancients of South Mountain. He also did, he got them involved after he found this to see if it was real. And he works for Archaeology Southwest. There is Aaron Hockey, new fan here. How are you guys? We're doing great, Aaron. How are you doing? I'm glad you're aboard on this Sunday afternoon as we throw down some stuff that we just kind of pondered today. And so they cut those bars, got in there, did whatever their scientific system is to see if how old that petroglyph was. And so they did the research to see how they did it. And if you go on PBS, there is a show about how they did that and what their conclusions that they came up with. And there is some very interesting stuff. If you look at, if it is a fraud, which is kind of making me lean that way now after watching the show, man, they did a lot of work. Somebody did a lot of work to try to make this farce up. And then you have to go, well, why would they even do that? So they do the dating. The first thing is there's something about the carbon that's in the air because of people, cars. So if there's a certain amount of that in the rock, they can tell that it's in a certain window. So they believe that definitely it was before the 1900s when they did that.
So they're doing carbon dating?
Well, then they do carbon dating on top of that. I mean,
dating, yeah, that's half-life, and that's called the dating game, and I wouldn't go with any of that stuff.
Well, they did three different ones. Okay, they did three different ones, and they came to the conclusion that it's 1800s, maybe the 1900, but it's not older than that. And they had, and I'm not scientific when it comes to that stuff, but it was pretty believable, their system that they put together to figure that out.
Well, The only reason I would question stuff like that and ever questioning what I call the dating game is that I've studied a lot into carbon dating and all this radiometric dating and all this stuff. And it's not a, it's not an exact science. And when I say that, was it barnacles on the bottom of a boat? I've seen them date these things that are living to 50,000 years old. So what, why they call it the dating game, especially in doing like evolutionary work, having the evolutionary theory, is that you'll see some things are dated sooner and later. It just all depends on somebody's worldview and how they want to date something. So I've never been a fan of that. So it would be interesting if they said they carbon date, I'd throw it away. Because I've read numerous books on carbon dating and half life, and you still have to know when the specific thing was there. You know what I'm saying? You have to know right. the original date to take right. half. So stuff like that, I would have to have even more evidence than dating rock, because it's hard to date rock.
Well, the big thing that got me was the inscription and not what it said. Because if you watch this show, you realize that there's a lot of things that didn't add up, you know, wasn't just one thing. So let's just, even if you threw the carbon dating out, the way he wrote his name, some of the letters, what's funny is whoever did it, let's just, if you want to say it's a farce or you don't want to say it's a farce, there's some letters that are accurate. Like they had to have found his name in a library, because again, this thing came up in the 20s, right? So even if it was done somewhere in that window, let's just say it was done in 1920, for example. Somebody would have had to go on the library and find this guy's name. They would have had to see how he signed his name, because some of the letters are accurate. That's what's crazy about it. So it wasn't that whoever did this farce, if it was a farce, actually had some accountability of how to write his name, but then missed on other things that he wouldn't have missed on, I don't believe. But then you got to go to, let's say it is or it isn't. Why would he have done it? Why would they have wrote that? Why would they have made that if it wasn't real? What's your thoughts?
Yeah, well, that's where I go. If we're going to date it to 1920, we're going 103 years ago. Pull up some imagery of 103 years ago in that location and see what's going on there, and not much. So for somebody to go to that location and to you know, drum up that at some point there's going to be this massive park in here, or you know, trying to sell property here, and this is going to make the property value go up. It just, it boggles my mind to think that somebody was thinking that in as early as, you know, 1920, which it could have been done a lot earlier than that. So we were talking earlier about, like, I'm 50-50 on this thing. I could care less if it's real or not. But I'm not going to say it's fake just because the TV show said it was fake. When we go out to Sears Point and we see those petroglyphs, because that's what they are, of the old 49ers and people who came across that trail heading to California, that one, it's, I believe, from either it's 1841 or 1851, I can't remember, that's in that rock, looks like it was done yesterday. They made that thing so pretty, and it looks so good, and the date is so good. I don't know if you have a picture of that. I'm gonna need to go through my archives while we're live here. Now, if I showed somebody that, they would be like, oh, somebody did that the other day. Unless they knew who the person was, and you can actually look up that person and find them in history. That's one great thing about like platforms like Ancestry and stuff like that. You can go out there and look and see if that person existed. Was he in California at that time? But so when I look at that, I'm saying you're chiseling this into a rock. How accurate are you going to be on how, like, if I put my name into a rock and you look at my signature, it's not going to be the same. I don't write my signature. I wouldn't try to write my signature on a rock. I would just try to peck it in bold letters as best as I possibly could onto the rock. So I don't get, maybe it's because the letter M or the letter A look different in the 15, you know, late 1500s, and nobody used the present day M. I can understand that, but go and anybody go to your, you know, try to chisel your name into a rock and look what it looks like. I don't see how you can do a comparison.
I'm getting ready to do that. Actually, I'm getting ready to actually build a, to do a, headstone for my dad at the ranch. And I'm actually going to chisel it in. Should be interesting. I'll take a video of it. Should be cool.
Now let's get into the, let's get into this New Mexico thing, because the thing is here, I would understand that the writing style, okay, again, what did the writing style look like in 1849? It wasn't the same as we have today. I wish I had a picture of the one that was in Sears Point, because that looks like it was done today by somebody. There's nothing on that one in Sears Point that's what, 1859, 50, that's what, 175, 180 years old, that looks that old. It looks like it was done, again, just yesterday. It's absolutely perfect. Wouldn't you say that one is perfect there?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I just thought of something kind of funny that I'm pretty sure there's only a handful of people in Phoenix, Arizona that know about this. This is kind of a secret thing. It's not secret, but I stumbled into a petroglyph one time in South Mountain that most people would never find because I was way off trail. I mean, I was way off trail, and I stumbled into this petroglyph, and I just thought about something, and this could have nothing to do with it, and it could have something to do with it. They used to take a lot of geology classes from ASU out there. And I'm taking it that it's ASU because they don't say the school, but they're in some school, geology school is what it says. And I take that for granted, it's ASU, but it may not be. But they have a listing of the students that were there. And that thing's dated 1900. And there's probably four or five names on it. And you know, if somebody did make this a farce, right, they would have to be, first off, pretty educated. You know, you just wouldn't throw this down. I mean, you just wouldn't build this, let's say, even if it is a farce, right? And I was thinking, you know what? Those petroglyphs those guys made, I would like to look at both of them now, the ones that the class put on that wall, because it's hidden there. Like I said, only a handful of people, I guarantee you, could ever tell me where it was at. And they were out there in 1900s, and there will only be a handful of people, seriously, in my thinking, that would have enough education in that era to even know to put that, right? There would only be a handful of people that would be smart enough, even if it was a farce, for example, like would know about who in the hell he even was to begin with.
Exactly. Exactly. And I guess I'm 21st century thinking because of our run-ins with the archaeology Southwest. But if these guys were those kind of people, you wouldn't think that they would be just out there etching in, you know, hoaxes into the Southwest deserts that maybe, you know, years later, we would think maybe it could be real. And we send people from PBS out there to do dating and stuff on it because, you know, those people had to have come out there thinking, why would they waste their resources? Didn't they see like, So I don't know who these people exactly were because I haven't watched the whole video, but obviously they were experts, right? So didn't they see a picture of the inscription and everything and the so-called New Mexico thing that's on there? Why would they travel and waste the money to come out there to test that when they could have just looked at it and said, well, it says New Mexico, and it doesn't even look like this guy's name, and that's not the kind of letters they used in the late 1500s. Why would they come out there and test it?
You know, that's a great question because, and it was funny that Aaron was in this. I didn't know Aaron was in it when I first saw this PBS special. I didn't have any idea he was involved with this or not. Now, anybody that doesn't know Aaron wrote a book. He wrote his thesis on the ancient man in South Mountain Park. And he wrote the book, and it's actually a pretty damn good book. And I guess he stumbled upon that as well. And brought it back to life. I mean, other people had definitely already seen it. And then maybe that was a connection for them to come out and think of it. Well, because it is important if it was true, it would mean that, you know, he was definitely the first guy. Well, actually Esteban is always going to be the first guy who was actually the lead going out there before Niza came out, But it would mean that he was the first guy in the Southwest, basically the first Spaniard that was in the Southwest. And, you know, whether that's important, evidently it must have been, because the city put this cage around it. I mean, isn't that crazy?
It is. And, you know, I'll get conspiracy on you here, or if it was real, if they said it was real, do you know what the outcry with a certain group of people who said they've been here since the beginning of time, what the outcry would be if we protected this Spaniard's name on this rock, but all the other rock that we see out there that's been etched in by all these certain people were not protected? There'd be a huge outcry that look at the Spaniards, they're important enough to get protected with somebody's name that came here in the 1500s. But the people who were here before that, theirs don't mean anything. I could just see the outcry in that.
Well, you know, it definitely is an interesting thing about, you know, all history, right? Because, you know, what would you say if we sat down and said, you know, I made a poll on that one time, and I'm trying to think what the question or the answer was, because it was like a percentage of how much history do you believe is completely true? You know, and with all the stuff that you read, you know, because we know that it's not all accurate, but how much of it isn't accurate? And I think the poll was 50% of the people believe that 50% or at least half the people believe that half of the history that we know is false. It's not accurate, you know, and it's hard to say, but you know, we know there's a lot of bias, and we know it, and it's not, this isn't a new thing in America. You know, they've always done that and tried to always push a certain amount. Don says they did it because it made a better show. And that might've made a better show when it came to, you know, for PBS to come out. But I think they really believed it to be true, though. I really do. I think they thought they had something, to be honest with you.
Yeah. It's like the really quick off topic here, the alien crash site when I went to Texas. The History Channel, this was not too long ago. This was like in 2017, 2018. They did a underground survey thing on the grave that this supposed alien is supposed to be buried in the cemetery I went to. And then the crash site and the well and stuff like that, that some of this stuff fell into. They went out there and they did a whole... And I truly believe, because the people in the community really took hold of this story that happened in the late 19th century, they went out there and they did it because so many people believed it. So I don't think they just go out there to do it because it's a story, because it costs a lot of money and it is public television, right? So it just seems like there was so many people who believed it to be true. But now we have one authority. I think it's only one, right? One authority that's been out there that said, no, this can't be true. And the second thing is, are they the one that demolished the bar on the top that I'm just talking about?
Well, I don't know if they demolished it, but they cut it. They cut the bars. And then they got in and did the dating that they had to, because they had to get up on it and they had to take some of it off, and then they welded it back.
Well, that would be part of this. If I went back, well, I'm going to put something on TikTok on this thing out there for people to make, you know, the choice whether it's true or not. But I find that interesting that they cut the bar to be able to get in there, because I thought somebody messed around with it and took a sledgehammer to it over time. And because if you look at the bar, even the bar that they replaced it in, and what year was this done that they were out?
You know, I don't remember I don't even know if it says on here if there's a date on
it. It's terribly put in. It's the bar, the black bar that's on the top, it's terrible, because you can put your whole hand in there.
You can tell.
Yeah, you can put your whole hand in there. It's right there. And it's like lower. So when I went to take the pictures, it was great for me, because I could put the camera right into the cage area to take the pictures. You can't do that really much. I mean, the other ones are pretty close together. So they did a really bad job on sealing that thing back up. Actually, it looks like crud, the job that they did. So I wonder when they did this.
I don't, you know.
Boy, if we did that to anything else, people would have it be in an uproar if we went and destroyed something that was...
Well, an archaeologist never changed suits. So this is the same suit. This works between 1950 and 2015. Yeah. I think. So that's,
oh, that's an archaeologist right there.
Yeah, I can't. No, I just do that. That's the guy that did Eduardo Paget is the guy that did. He did a lot of the research for. He's like the guest guy in there.
And
he's pretty good. He's pretty good.
So he did the research, and without the dating method, he did the research. And what did he? What was his conclusion?
Fake. It was fake.
See, that's what I don't understand why they did all this. It doesn't make any sense to me. And then we were talking about this earlier. I would love to know the date they put the cage on there.
Yeah, that I don't know. That I do not know when they. And then that still is a unbelievable cage. For, you know, whoever put that there. I mean, that's unbelievable. I mean,
it's old time work. That's back in the days where when they did something, they did something right.
Well, my buddy's pre-war would look at that and say, man, if we could just have cages around every petroglyph like that, it would be sweet.
I'm surprised they don't.
Sweet. Like if I could just cover entire Sears, you know, point completely in cage steel.
Cage Sears Point, cage the Adamsville Mound in, cage it all in. So if we could just walk on top of the cages, like we're the animals, you know, and we're trying to get to see this history.
Well, what about, and minefields would work. Put minefields out there and you'd be coming home with no leg.
Yeah.
You'd be like, well, I was not looking at petroglyphs today. Here's a piece of history though, that, and then some people say that the guy that owned the land also is the guy that found it, which is kind of weird. Well, you know, the guy
that would be right. Right. That would be, if I owned the land, I would be walking it and you know, and checking it out. Again, it's the location. I would love to know if there's a picture of the guy that owned the land back in the 1920s, what it looks like. Because when you look out there now, it's nothing but rows of homes. But where was the farm at for this place? I mean,
hard to say,
in a very interesting location.
Those, you know, if he was trying to sell that land, those houses there didn't go up until the 90s or something. Oh,
yeah,
you know,
at least.
You know,
at least.
So that didn't, you know, if that was his ploy, it didn't work. No. You know, that was something that people threw out there. I'm really liking my new theory about this, these students that used to go travel out there in the geology class. And one of them said, you know, we could pull a farce that would be unbelievable, but they would probably come, well, then who knows? But, you know, again, one thing about it is this, it's someone that did it was educated, because there is some ways that they strew the lettering that is like his actual signature, because the Spanish had all their notes. They had, you know, they kept such great notes on all the things that they did. And so he, you know, they have his signature, and a couple of the letters are accurate, and you wouldn't have just known it unless you'd have seen it. You just wouldn't have guessed it. And then some of them are definitely not accurate. But that's what got me, was that, so somebody who did this, they knew, they had some idea. And they probably never thought in a million years you'd be able to look at this stuff online, because there was no computers and things like that. You know, that sounds right up a bunch of geology.
No, because their moral integrity is way better than all of ours, according to, you know, these people. That's why I say somebody would have said, I mean, unless they're just, again, you go back up onto a really quick hieroglyphic trail, which I think is the second most trafficked trail in the valley. With all the petroglyphs up there, the only, you know, they get upset with us showing petroglyphs and stuff and locations. You know, during every, outside of summer, it probably 1,000 people a day up there. The only one that's marked up that rock is the class of 1920. That's the only ones that's marked up a rock that you see is the class of 1920.
Yeah,
and we don't find that so bad, because that's 103 years ago. So anything that's older is okay. But nobody else has marked up that rock. It would be hard for me to believe that. You know, I understand what you're saying there, but it's just a weird thing, because we need to do research and find out when they found it, you know, who owned the land, when they found it, and then when they decided to put the cage up on it. I think that's even a more intriguing story than someone going out and trying to carbon date whether the rock is old or young.
Well, one thing I can say, though, is I do know they're capable because I found petroglyphs that they built themselves. So I do know that they're capable of doing, you know, doing this work out there, whether they did or not. But I could see some kids going, you know, this would be really funny. You know, we could really have fun with this because, again, remember, I found the fact that they were out there because they made a petroglyph. You know, they built their own petroglyph.
How far away from the location are we talking about, though?
It is up. So when you see the hand, you see the petroglyph of people holding hands. Mm-hmm. You take that creek up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You take that creek up to the top of the ridge, the first ridge. So that's where they were at. But yeah, remember, too, in the day that they were there, they got to drive to that point. Right. So they, you know, the parking lot used to be right there for them. They didn't have to walk like we do 8,000 miles up the flat road. They were able to drive right up there and then walk up that hill. So it wasn't that far from that area. So, you know, again, they had cars and it would have been easy for them to be able to drive right up to it or ride horseback at the night. You know, I'm trying to remember what year that was, that says on there, Aaron saw on top of Hayden Butte, I found a 1945 tag. You know, people are all over that. I mean, you know, that's what's funny is that there's a lot of stuff that, you know, he was looking for gold. That's a high gold area, South Mountain is, you know, so that would make sense. There would have been water because that's where the Indians were, right? So he definitely could have been there. It's not such a far push. And then he talks about trying to find a city that was as big as Mexico City. And I don't know anywhere where there would be a city as big as Mexico City at one time, with the exception of the city that was 30,000 people where ASU stands. Now, that wouldn't have been there at that time. It had been previous to that. But there's no place that I could see that, because he said he was going to find a city that was close to the size of Mexico City. And there wouldn't have been anything in that era that I can think of other than, you know, at that time, especially in the late 1500s or mid 1500s, even at that era, there, even the biggest tribes weren't that many people at that in that time. But I don't disbelieve he could have been there. I don't disbelieve that he could have stumbled into to Phoenix, Arizona. That's not something I believe couldn't happen. I believe he definitely could have been there. And so when they found this, what it must have been the greatest find ever for him to put that cage there, right? I mean, that's ridiculous.
That's what I'm saying. They you know, again, this, we're saying 1920. We don't know. It could have been earlier than that. They knew the name. They knew the name to be important. They had to have known he was in Southern Arizona, all over the place. It had to have some significance to it. I mean, it's like us looking for, you know, the old petroglyphs on, do we know that every petroglyph we're looking at is truly an ancient petroglyph?
Nope.
Or did somebody else came along in the 1700s? And started putting it on there? Because, you know, even the one with everybody holding hands, everybody's intrigued with that one, because I put that out on a petroglyph site, got like 260 hits. And the thing was people were analyzing that thing to the T. They were blowing it up, and you can see it. That is a later petroglyph, the ones that you can see holding hands, because there's one underneath it that looks completely different. So you just, I don't know if somebody else didn't come along and see that, and maybe that's what it was, and then retraced it to you know, in the early 1800s for people to see it again. We can't carbonate every rock. I think we'd get in trouble if we started carbonating some of those rocks with playing those games, because they'd have to go with the later date, because you're going to get a couple of dates when they do it. That was my point. Is you're going to get a bunch of dates that differ from each other, and you're going to find the closest date to the time that you believe that the people were there in the valley, and you're going to date it to that date. So if a date comes up 1000 AD, another date comes up 1800s, and the other one comes up closer to present time, you're gonna take the latest date and say that's the date that we're going to use. There is no pinpoint accuracy when they date rock like that.
You know, the only place I had ever been that I believe that the petroglyph that I saw was Spanish was the one we saw down at Southern Arizona on the Road of the Devil. And but you definitely know that some of these petroglyphs aren't real. A lot of it, even if they're in the middle of nowhere, because there's no middle of nowhere back then, everybody was everywhere in the middle of nowhere back in sometimes, depending on the routes and the trails. You know, we know that for Sears Point, that has a lot of years of petroglyphs. I mean, there is all kinds of people that were stopping in there as they went through their journey. And so we know there is a lot of different stuff. And again, you know, you get where you can kind of tell the ones that aren't or have some type of look that you're kind of curious of. And also the fact that they use metal to be able to make them. It's a heck of a lot easier to make petroglyphs when you have any type of steel. I don't care what it is. You know, you have some type of way to be able to hit the rock other than rock on rock. And so, you know, with this deal here, it, you know, the New Mexico thing doesn't throw me as much because I still could say that people could say this was going to be for the New Mexico, not New Mexico, the state, but Mexico, and for New Mexico. It's going to be New Mexico, right? So that doesn't throw me as that not being that couldn't have been misconstrued, that part of it. That doesn't throw me at all. What throws me is the lettering. The lettering does not fit that era. But then again, the other side of the coin is this too. Just like we know that Kit Carson, who we don't know when he signed his name on rocks, even though he couldn't write, sometimes he knew how to spell his name. He knew how to do his name, even though he couldn't really write. But did somebody else do it for him? You know, some of this kind of stuff. Did you know, could somebody even in this party put that on there that wasn't him himself, right? Could that be possible? Absolutely. It could be. We don't really know that. We really don't know it.
Yeah, that's what I would go with. It wasn't him personally that stuck it in there, but it was somebody that was traveling inside his group that may have went farther out one direction and farther out the other direction. I mean, you don't see it anywhere else. Have they found his name carved in the rocks anywhere else in the state of Arizona or New Mexico or Nevada or any of those places?
Not that I'm aware of. Not even in the special place in New Mexico where everybody signs their names. I don't think his name is on there. I don't think that, you know, I've not seen anything, you know, even with Kit Carson, he is supposed to be in three places. There's supposed to be three places. And then again, the first thing that I saw when you're doing the research is that he couldn't spell. He couldn't read and write. Well, he was like Geronimo. Geronimo couldn't either, but Geronimo could write his name because he got paid to do it. So there's some intriguing stuff that goes along with this that definitely makes you wonder. Carbon dating needs organic matter, carbon. You could use another form of radiometric dating, though.
Yeah. Again, that's why it's called the dating game when you do studies on it, because it just fits your worldview. I'll leave it at that. If you're a certain individual that wants to date something to a certain time, you can get as many dates as you possibly can out of one testing. And then you go with that date. You go with the date that meets, you know, if you believe that something was somewhere at a certain time, you get the closest result from that date and you do it. When I studied that stuff, I'm like, how can they even call this stuff scientific? Because there are dates of things that are alive that are dated over a million years old and they're living. So it's speculative, very speculative.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, even if you do five different tests, right? Does the lettering look right? Is the verbiage look right? Does the the carbon dating look right? Does the, you know, you can lay this down, but
you have nothing to compare it to.
But
you don't have his name on any other rock. If somebody else was doing, like if I did your name, you know, right. It would look nothing like you. How you would write your name, obviously, it'd be chiseled on a rock. And I mean, how you know, if I'm 15, 40 something, how intrigued am I going to be on doing everything correct when I'm just chiseling something into a rock? And I don't know 500 years later that Dean and Jeff and all these shows are going to be out there speculating on whether this thing is real or not.
Well, and that's the thing too. Even if you have, Don's basically saying that a range of dates is better than no dates.
I don't think so.
You've got a window to peer through is how I'm gathering that.
But what would your window be if in 2023 you've dated something and it says it's a million years old and the thing is still alive today? It wouldn't make any sense. That window is humongous and it's still alive today. That in itself, when you start looking at carbon dating, I would just tell anyone, do their own research, read a couple of books on it, and look at things that they've dated and how they figure what date that they're going to use, because they are way too far away, especially in carbon dating. They're just way too far away. I'll leave that point alone for now. But really, you know, cool. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you know, the thing that's interesting to me still is that, you know, it's kind of like when you go in there and you find out something is not real, for example. But then the part that intrigues me just as much is there's always some type of history involved in it that I'm amazed by. So even if it's real, I'm amazed. But even if it's not a real, I'm amazed. But is this just some big, you know, hoax? And if it is, it's kind of cool. To me, it is. Yeah. I don't look at it as being bad, because look how much energy got and money got thrown at this thing that somebody might have just scribbled. Somebody in a Latin class might have just scribbled this stuff down, or a Spanish class, and as a big joke. And then one day everybody makes a big deal out of it. I think that it would be. I think it's kind of funny.
Well, it makes for a lot of views, is what it does. Let's just talk about the other place that has that story that we'll never know if it's true or not, but it's probably more made up than it's true. It's probably 80% false, 20% true, but everybody loves it. And that's a place called the Apache Death Cave. Everyone goes there. It gets hundreds of thousands of views on my channels every time I put it out there. It would be worth me driving 4 hours from here to go do another video on it, because I know it's going to get a lot of views. And look, I think we all believed it to be fake. I mean, majority of what's down there is fake anyhow. But everybody's intrigued with this story of the Navajo and the Apaches, and they believe that they were, you know, they were burned in down there. So just because that story has stuck, everybody loves that story.
Yeah, absolutely they do. It's a great story. The problem is that it might just be a story. Well, you know, I don't know if you've ever read the story about the dog track that used to be up on the 17. What is that? Black Canyon City. There is a story. There used to be a dog track there. I don't know if you remember that. There used to be a dog track that was real. The dog track was really there. It was on the left-hand side of the road, which would be on the west side. And there was a great story, and you can still find it now, about the guy that owned the track, and there was poisoning and everybody got poisoned. And it was this unbelievable, cool story that just wasn't true, but it is a great story. It really is one of the most awesome stories. And it's so good. You want it to be true because you can't believe it, but there's a good reason you can't believe it, you know, but is that creeping into that same thing where they take a character like Jesse James and make him Robin Hood? You know, Jesse James is Robin Hood now. Oh, well, that makes it better. It makes it good. I mean, it makes our history more fun. For a guy like Jesse James, for example, and I'm just throwing out one, it could be Doc Holliday. It could be all these different guys that people are just fascinated with these names. But you look at how much of the truth is there. And there is a lot of truth to Jesse James and Doc Holliday and Wyatt Earp and all these characters that lived. But there's a lot of false as well that is just made up history.
Yeah, most definitely. One of the guys I was looking up when I was up in Globe, using the ancestry system, I was looking up these census reports, and I can't tell what's true or not. because somebody has an article from when the guy died. And usually an obituary, I mean, you're not going to tell falsities in it, especially the people that are living, they know. And there was a lot of stuff about this gentleman I was like, well, I'm going to run with it because I'm going to go with, you know, what was written after he died. But when I went and started looking where he was, some of this stuff didn't mix. Some of this stuff says that he's in Arizona and he's a pioneer of Arizona. But in 1860, in close to 1870, he's in New York with his family. But then I listened to stories about people who have been in the globe, and these are some of the people who have been there the longest. But then I'm looking at real paperwork with real names on it, and I'm like, they did get here, but they got here kind of late. So was he here during Jack Swilling and helping him dig out the ditch? Well, it says it in his obituary. It says it in other spots, but seems to me that he wasn't even in the state in 1870. He couldn't have been here in 1867, but he's credited with being with the Jack Swilling party back then. So it is, it's the research sometimes is, you know, if we went by, we had to have 100% fact when we're posting about some of these characters we're finding in the great state of Arizona over time, we couldn't post anything.
No, I agree with that. And, you know, here's the thing. It's not like there's a little bit of truth and a lot of false. It's like there's a lot of truth that we don't even know. There's these stories that are fabulous that we don't even know about that are even more impressive than the hoaxes, right? There are these stories that are fabulous. Pat Masterson, the dude, he needs to come out of the wood. We need to get him out of the woodwork. He was every one of those characters that was the legend of the Wild West from what I have read. He was just too humble to say it. He gave Wyatt Earp, he gave these guys all these kudos that, and from what I could read was this dude was the guy, man. He was John Slaughter. There were guys out there that were just unbelievable that don't get any press when these other people, the Wyatt Earps of the world, not to say that Wyatt Earp was horrible, but I just don't think he lived up to the expectations that his legend of the movie Tombstone gave him. I mean, I don't think he lived, you know, he didn't live up to that from what I understand, Bat Masterson did. The guy was a phenomenal. I mean, and so I guess our job is to dig out those guys where it's true, the truth of those guys, because we know a lot of the stuff, the big name guys, there's a lot of falsities there. I like the fact you got the books back out because back up again.
Coronado, it's copyright day of 1949, that book. And I was trying to see if I could look up some stuff really quick on that gentleman. And because I know he's in that book, but I only read like 50 pages of that book like 2 years ago before I put it on the shelf. And then I was looking for the Doc Holliday book that I got around here somewhere that was written about a guy who lives in Tombstone all his life. And I bought it at the Birdcage Theater. And the guy said, that's probably the most accurate book you're going to see on Doc Holliday. And it is phenomenal from when he's born in Georgia to when he dies in Colorado. And you got Doc Holliday, again, when you say interesting, you know, you got Doc Holliday taking out maybe 2-3 people tops in his life that's actually... And when people are like, well, you just don't know. Well, yes, you do. Because you got places like Fort Griffin, when you're around a military base that he was supposed to do taking out a few people. And all these other places in Las Vegas, New Mexico and stuff. And people are like, well, it hit the papers, folks. If you get newspapers.com, which will cost you, I don't know, it's like $20 a month. It is fun. Read. Because most of these newspapers are from the 1860s, 1870s. They're there. And you can read about it. And the guy who did, he comes to the conclusion at the end, you know, there were some things that Doc Holliday was credited with like in Las Vegas, New Mexico. And he's like, look, it was a big enough town that had a newspaper that we can read through and document. And there ain't nothing in there. But the funny thing is, the stories that he's credited with taking the people out and having these knife fights with, you can find them in the papers, but it's related to somebody totally different. So they just took that story when Doc Holliday left town and when he becomes this famous guy, and they take that story and they they put Doc Holliday as that guy that was in that gunfight, that was in that knife fight, that, you know, that was out in the street shooting at the bad guys and stuff like that. It's very interesting how we've propped this guy up. And that book, I wish I can find it to show you. That book is phenomenal. I'm going through it like for the second time because it's so well documented.
Well, I'm going to grab a book here while I'm sitting. I'm going to grab a book in the same range here. And I'm going to pull one off the shelves myself.
Woohoo.
And because, I mean, this kind of stuff changes your mind of what you read, right?
Right.
Because you can read a lot of books on the life and adventures of Jesse James or the James brothers. This is the life and adventures of the James brothers right here, right there. And what's neat about it is that when you read this one, you're not getting an interpretation from what happened back in the day from nowadays, right, to back on. This is 1882. So it's still a ways away from when he died. Right. But at least they were talking to people back in that day that were alive at the time. And, that's what I love about that. There's Quantrell's black flag right there. They got a picture of that. Even back then, that was a big deal. But that's what's cool about this book to me is that, you know, when I read it, it's talking in the era of when the accounts happen. I don't care who it is, but it's neat to be able to see that I think you get a better accurate, you know, litmus test of who these guys really were. But then again, this could even be swayed too. This could be a pro Southern. It could be a pro Northern, you know, it could be swayed in that direction.
And what's the copyright again, in that day book? What's the copyright of that book? The copyright of that book?
1882.
Yeah, see, that's, I would take that as a lot of truth, if it's written in 1882. Again, yeah, I read a report one time where bias started slipping into books after a copyright date of 1949. I was always told when I loved history and going out from a gentleman to say, look, if you can ever find books that are copyrighted before 1949, of all the research that they've done on books and history, instead of people's opinion being put in the book and people being swayed one way or the other, a lot of the books prior to that copyright date were based on fact, were based on evidence. We're not trying to come to their own conclusion on who maybe Doc Holliday or Wyatt Earp was, giving you the actual, you know, legit of the time, what's there, what's the facts, what's the fiction. I was always told, that's why I'm always at used bookstores looking for books, especially history books dated pre-1949.
What's amazing to me, even the history of the book of the book itself, not even what the subject is the fact that, you know, 138 years ago, that was sitting on somebody's shelf, like your shelf right there. Right. And that, you know, what they were going through and the people that's touched this book and read this book and the, whatever the thought process was behind it. You know, one thing I learned about Poole, for example, Poole is buried here in Arizona. He was a bushwhacker and he was in the border wars, was kind of the guy that kept sane when it came to decisions being made. And so when finally the North had decided that, you know, they were pretty much going to win the war, the bushwhackers didn't want to come in. And Poole was the guy that said, hey, if you don't come in, they're going to hunt you down and kill you. So, you know, he told that to Jesse James and Frank James and all those guys that were in that group, you know, the younger brothers. And Poole ended up, you can get all kinds of transcripts because these guys became superstars. All the people back in those days, they became big deals. They were celebrities. You know, they were rock stars. And the thing that's cool about these guys, and it doesn't matter which side you're on, is they got a lot of press. So there's a lot of information on people after the Civil War on the Grants and the Lees and all these guys because they were celebrities. And so all these newspapers wrote a lot of stuff about him. So you can find a lot of stuff about these characters. And that's how I found David Poole is buried in Phoenix, Arizona. And so are a lot of other Union and Confederates that got the heck out of the war-torn Midwest and East Coast. They got out of there. They got out of the South, and they came West for new lives. And it's fascinating how many people are in Phoenix, Arizona, buried that were in the war. It's incredible to me.
Quite a few of them. Quite a few, all the way from Civil War people, the Buffalo Soldiers and stuff like that. A lot of people came to Arizona after Civil War, after the Apache Wars and stuff like that. You can see that just downtown in Phoenix. They have their whole separate military cemetery there. And you, as every pioneer cemetery I've been in, has a pretty good amount of especially Civil War individuals buried there.
Well, you know, we've kind of found out lately from the little interaction we've had lately, because of you opened some of them books behind you, you know, about these cemeteries being gold mines for these, for the amount of history information that's out there, is that these cemeteries that are out there, you know, every time I go back to, I think it's Green Lawn, because aren't they all called Green Lawn? Something like that. They're all, they're basically
Green Lawn or Evergreen.
Evergreen, that's, Green, yeah. Lawn. I mean, it's like they all, there's this grouping of names that they, well, anyway, the one in Independence, every time I go there, I find somebody new. I find another story. I find somebody that intrigues me. I, you know, or I'm reading another book that say, well, they were buried, there. And it's like, man, I didn't even know it. So every time I go back, it's like there's a new character that gets popped out. And I find that fascinating, that we don't let these people die there in that graveyard.
Yeah. You know, my favorite's Globe. It was Evergreen until 2 days ago. Now it's Globe, because there's probably 30 or 40,000 burials there. And there's only 11 that I know quite a bit about. And I've traveled up there to find the graveyards. And that was done but 2 days ago, to find two more. Every time I dig into these books, I find these names in history, like the Matilda Moores, who's involved in the Oatman rescuing of the Lorenzo Oatman after the massacre in 1851. To read that and know that Lorenzo was 15 when he was beaten down by him and survived and got back to the road. And Matilda Moore was all by herself, or her brother dies, her parents died, and she's 15 at the time. And the stuff that these guys went through, she went from South Carolina to California, but then again, like I said, knew the Oatmans. The Oatmans were in her 20-wagoned trail. You know, you watch, what is it, 1863 or something, 1883, when you watch that show, it was so popular. Well, this is 1851, and what these people are going through and what this young girl went through is amazing. And then she's buried in the Globe Cemetery, and she was a resident of Globe for a very long time. And when I put that video out, a lot of people that live in Globe watched, and they're like, she was a legend up here in Globe when she passed away. Yeah, you wouldn't, I've never heard her name before. I went up there, and she's right by the great, Apache Scout Al Sieber's grave, not too far away from that. And every time I go up there, I'm like, there's another one. There's another one. You know, the feud people, the Tewksbury's are up there. It's quite an amazing, amazing place. If I lived in Globe, that would be one of my like part-time little things that I do. Instead of the Arizona Timeless Tours, I just go up into the Globe Cemetery, take pictures, and start researching these people, because you would come across some stories that, like hers, that are absolutely amazing, that need to be brought back out into the light. So when you're talking about the Oatmans, that's another name that you can throw in. You know, when Lorenzo, when he finally got to there and he's about done, that those wagons that stayed at the Pima villages and didn't want to carry on like the Oatmans did, they got themselves rested and back on the trail. And they're back on the trail. And who do they see on the side of the trail just about on death's door but him? And they rescue him, and he lives, you know, many more years.
You know, we were talking about that, and I was telling you, one of the most intriguing things to me is when you can cross the dots, you know, cross the T's and dot the dots and follow the and track that stuff, and you can follow these people's lives. I find it fascinating. Whether anybody else does or not, I really don't care. It intrigues me when I see these people and you see how they bump into each other. And, you know, I talked about it just last week about how the Binghams and the Wagners in that big house and how they're now interrelated with Harry Truman and how the money moved forward and all the people moved from, you know, from here to the West. And they got rich because they had this flour that in this mill that all these pioneers were taking all that West and they just made a fortune. And you see these power struggles and these people and how they intertwined. And to me, it's fascinating. What a fascinating time in history where, you know, these people would have been going West. You know, they're leaving places like Independence, Missouri, which were at the time safe and modern at that point. Right. And all of a sudden they're going out into something they don't even know. They don't know what they're getting into. You know, there's a story about a young gal who left Independence and the first, and again, we're not talking about somebody that these people didn't, some of them didn't know how to do this stuff. They're learning how to be these wagon train people. They're getting trained on the job. Some of them came from the East Coast, but most of them got on a riverboat and got to Kansas City, basically. But some of them went the whole road, but they didn't know how to do this stuff. They didn't know how to run a wagon train. I mean, they weren't skilled at that kind of stuff. And they risked everything they had and got on those wagon trains. And man, you think about the courage it would have taken to do that, or stupidity, what, depending on, you know, you look at the openings, that was a lot of bad calls. He did it was a horrible calls he made, you know?
Yeah.
Horrible.
And you figure that's, you know, 1883, we're all watching that. This is 1851 Southwest. The Gadsden Purchase. This is before all of that stuff. 1851, they're on this trail. One of the very first people. Just to keep this story of Arizona going on, I'm going to read this quote that I sent to you about this place. It says, the words of Arizona pioneer James N. Barney in an Arizona Highways article published in June of 1936 described the tiny frontier settlement. And I won't mention the name until we get to the end of it. No more historic spot exists in all of this Southwest country than the site that once, in a now far distant day, was the lively and flourishing stage station of Maricopa Wells. This man is the historian in Arizona, and the 1936 Highways magazine says that there is no more historic spot that exists in the Southwestern country than Maricopa Wells. And how many people know the story of Maricopa Wells?
I would say none, because I remember stumbling on it we were talking about that. We were talking about where it was at, but we didn't know much about it. We didn't know where it was at. Well, then we knew where it was at, but it was like, well, you know, you can't get there because you can't go on the land. But it was like, well, you know, is that, and that's when I was looking at the Mormon Christmas camp, right? And kind of working through that. And then all of a sudden, you know, you drop some knowledge out of a book that just changes everything. And you realize that this place was unbelievable. I mean, the funny thing, Dean, that's kind of crazy to me is that you don't think about like 1850 to 1880 until you think of 30 years in your world. Well, what was 30 years? Well, I was 35, right? Wow, 35. Holy crap, I was young, you know? And you realize the difference in the era of what you were thinking when you were 35 versus what you're thinking at 50 or 60 or 70 or whatever you are. And then you realize that's a big window of technology, even for them. That there was a lot of stuff that changed between the wagon train and the railroad and all that, and all that change that happened in that era. And it's absolutely unbelievable when you think of it that way.
Well, it's a shame that nothing really exists out there. Here's another quote from the book I was reading on. It says, little over 100 years ago, it was the most important location in Arizona territory. It was on the mind and on the tongue of every traveler through central Arizona. For everyone passing through, whether it be north or south or east or west, eagerly sought it. It was the principal crossroads of Arizona territory, and its name is Maricopa Wells. And when you start seeing how early in the 1850s, all the way through the 1880s till the railroad came, and then that was pretty much it. It kind of closed down a little bit in the 1860s. But going back to Matilda Moore, who was in the Oatman stuff, her husband and her three children worked there from they owned it. Her husband owned Maricopa Wells from 1872 to 1879 before they moved in 1880 to Globe, Arizona. And they said that 1872 to 1879, that was the heyday of Maricopa Wells. So this is what attached me to Matilda Moore. She was also named Matilda Crampton and Matilda Bennett before she was. So you got to trace her throughout history. But this woman, this little girl from South Carolina, is on a wagon train from South Carolina to California. What she saw, a diary needed to be written about that. What was it like going from South Carolina to California, leaving out in 1850, going through the whole Oatman thing in 1851, going across, marrying the gentleman who owns Maricopa Wells in its heyday, and living on site from 1872 to 1879. Who they saw come through there, what it was like. Too bad she didn't write a diary, because I would love to read a book that this woman wrote. And she probably didn't know, living out her life, that this was going to be such historic stuff.
You know, every major character in Arizona Southwest history would have crossed through Maricopa Wells. Yes. Every single one of them. I mean, that you talk about probably the biggest intersection in history, probably in the Southwest, was probably that location. Everybody would have had to gone through there. I mean, it's fascinating when you think about, if you can just stand out there and just think about how many people passed your way. Yeah. Was unbelievable. It just hit me that everybody would have crossed there, north, south, east, west. And everybody going west or going east or going north or going south would have crossed through Maricopa Wells. So every character in the play of history would have stepped through that crossroads. It's just a dusty location, on the map, and nobody's there and nobody can go there. But there's
nobody
nothing
can go there because it's reservation land.
But I will stand on that ground one day. I don't know how, but I will stand on that ground one day.
I think that as many people as we talk to, as we go around, we will find somebody that's a card carrying member of the Maricopa Native American community. And you just got it, just like where the other stuff is out there. You just got to find that one individual that knows where it's at and has authorization to be on it and to bring you on it, so you can go out there. I can only imagine what in again, this is just for instance, not that we would ever dig on that property.
Exactly.
If you took a metal detector out there,
yeah,
on the road that you knew that 40-mile stretch to the mountain, that's why everyone came through there, so they didn't have to go with the Gila River, and that's an extra 100 miles instead of 40, so you're going an extra 60 miles instead of 40. If you could just follow that pathway with a metal detector or with some kind of device that knows what's in the ground, what you would find along that path.
It'd be incredible. Because most of that stuff has never been run for years and years and years. Once Maricopa shut down, that shut down. Then the railroad came. Nobody went on the trails at all. Nobody. So it's not like people came through there or did anything. There's Rock to Crystals. What's up, Rock to Crystals? Thank you very much. That's much appreciated. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that would be intriguing. I'm sure you'd find artifacts on the top of the ground that you wouldn't really even need to dig into the ground if you knew the road that they were riding through. But yeah, it's interesting. I pulled up an 1870 census on Maricopa Wells, and one of the coolest things was, first of all, it's 2 pages long. It holds 30 names. I believe 40 names per page, and the other page wasn't completely done. So it had about 60 people living full time in Maricopa Wells and was on the census. And Charles and the marshal of the census on the right hand side said Charles Scheibel was written on there. And that's just another thing in history where you start studying names, and he's at the Evergreen Cemetery. Charles Scheibel, if anyone is responsible for helping Wyatt Earp become a sheriff or a deputy anywhere before we knew him, it was Charles Scheibel. He gave him his first law enforcement job. But he's buried in the Evergreen Cemetery. And we can go on and on about his story and who he married and the massacre they had with Larsenia Pennington Page. Again, the stories go on and on. But his name was on that census. But when you look at that census, you see 60 names that were attached to living full-time at Maricopa Wells in 1970.
You know, it's funny how you start to, you know, just peel the layers back of history. And it really is interesting to see. You know, there's a little town in between Maricopa and Gila Bend, because I stumbled on these two cemeteries down there. There's two of them, two cemeteries. If you go on Google Earth, which is the greatest thing ever in existence is Google Earth. There's two cemeteries that are down there, and there shouldn't be anything there, but there was a town called, I think, Chamotte, that's not there anymore. And I don't even know what it was, but it was right off the road. And that's another one. And there was two cemeteries there that go with it. Now, I haven't been able to really dig anything up. I don't know what kind of town it was. I think it was more of a railroad station back when they finally put the railroad and went through there, which is really heavily trafficked now. But there's just so many things when you start peeling back these layers of history that you just are fascinated by, because you just, I mean, the stuff is out there, and to me, it's some of these people did such amazing things. And even though a lot of the history is skewed, there's so much history that's not. Some of the careers that these people took that it were just fascinating. Can you imagine being in Globe or Prescott back in the day? You know, when these towns became these meccas where if you had money or you found any kind of fame or wealth, or you just got tired of being, you know, fighting for your life every day out in the middle of nowhere, you go into these locations like Globe and Prescott, and you have this modern world you would have stepped in. And all these people that stumbled in there after they found some type of wealth outside of these cities. And we know how important it is because we know the people that were buried there, and they wouldn't have been buried there unless they had some type of history or connection to the town. Yeah.
I was looking really quick at all of the stage stations from the Gila Bend from coming into Arizona and going through. And what's crazy is when I was looking at going to check out some of these World War II sites on Interstate 8 today, instead of going to South Mountain Park, as I was doing Google, because we're in agreement on Google, I was going along Interstate 8 trying to check some places out. Stanwyck Station, that's the second station along the way. That's on somebody GPS the coordinates to Stanwyck Station, and the foundation of Stanwyck Station is right along Interstate 8. Along with there was one other one on here. And I also talked about going Casablanca. Casablanca was where the giant was found. That was called Casablanca before they changed, after they changed the name later on after the fort had left. So where the giant was found was called Casablanca. That was another station that still exists out there, that still exists today. And what was the other one really quick? But it, what's great about this little thing here is it lists all of them. Like you're going from Kenyon Station was the first one. And that station is named after Charles Kenyon, the one that I just put my last TikTok out on, the guy that was supposedly here when dig out the wells and do all this stuff. And I'm like, well, there's differing things on the census forms, but they changed the name of one of the stations to Charles Kenyon Station. So the guy must have been something, and he must have been in Arizona at least by 1864 to have the name of the station. That's one of the first stations there. Then you have Burke Station, Stanwyck Station, the Painted Rocks right there was a station. Rattlesnake Hill. Oh, here's the other one, Mohawk Station. If you ride old Interstate 80 along Interstate 8 and you keep going across on Google Earth, you'll come to Mohawk Station. And the remnants of that you can see from Google Earth. So you can just drive there, get off, and you will be in Mohawk Station. Antelope Peak. It's got to be by the places that you've seen these petroglyphs by.
I know where that one was at. I know where that stopping station. I've been at that location estimated because it had pictures up until like 1930 of some of the stuff that was still there. And then they put a railroad bridge across. So, and I've been to Stanwyck Station, which still has remnants.
And yeah, that's where you can see it from Google Earth with no problem. There's still remnants there of that station.
And, you know, that being the first skirmish of the Civil War, you know, the farthermost western skirmish, you know, it's amazing when you're down there and you're sitting there and you're thinking the fact that 100 people came that way when Swilling was catching the hay on fire. So here's he's down there catching the hay on fire as the North come in. And so there was 100 men that chased him off. And then that led eventually to the skirmish at Picacho Peak, with basically the same groups of people in a different battle, different results as well. But it's fascinating to be on that Stanwyck Station. It really is. That's a cool one.
Yeah, so Stanwyck, and you just go a little bit farther. I want to say maybe 5 or 6 miles, and Mohawk Station is right there. So it would be cool to go on the Google Earth and try to find all of these, because a lot of people have done their. I'll give them props if they ever come out and say I did that. So people who laid the pins to those locations, because people have gone there pretty recent to lay the GPS markers to those, because you would go right over them. You would go right over them. You wouldn't know where they were at until you see that pin and it's marked there that is the station. So you could follow that. It'd be great to take a map and map out all. There's about 17 stations that go across, and your main station being Maricopa Wells, and just follow that. And maybe you'll be able to hit each one of those and go to each one of those locations. Would be pretty cool, because most of them are along Interstate 8. Right. I mean, that Interstate 8 pretty much follows the Butterfield Overland Mail coach thing, the Pony Express, all that stuff, the Jackass Mail, everything that came before Butterfield, all that was right along Interstate 8.
Well, and also they used to stop at Stanwyck Station and then take a side route to Caliente, Agua Caliente, to go to the hot springs.
Yeah,
right. And so they had a lot of traffic in between there going back and forth to get back, you know, and used to run that line. And then you go there, then you've got King's Woosley there, who's buried downtown. There's a whole nother fascinating story of that dude.
Well, the cool thing is you have Camp Horn that's right up at those hot springs too. So the remnants of all those buildings up there around the hot springs and stuff is Camp Horn,
right,
which was used during Patton to do that top secret mission training in the desert in there. And you can still see, I saw that's again where I was going to go today, but I just didn't feel like driving that far by myself. You have the barracks are still up along the road there. You have it's a ghost town, but people have, it says no trespassing. You can't go inside these buildings, but you can see all the,
I know a guy that did go in there once.
Yeah. You can see all the buildings, and I've seen somebody do a video. It's got some wallpaper and stuff up inside there, but it's a cool little spot. And then if you go farther up that road to the end, to where the fields are at, the farms, and take a left for 2.5 miles, you come to the Camp Horn Monument. This is huge. I would say it's about the size of High Jolly's pyramid where he's buried. There's a pyramid dedicated to the 8th Infantry, I want to say it is, for the United States Army, that perished during the training out there.
Yes.
But it's just the craziest thing that that thing sits that far off the freeway at the end of a dirt road, or 2 miles off of the main road onto a dirt road. I think it's a total of 18.5 miles off of the interstate. And there on the edge of the farm sits a pyramid dedicated to these people where Patton was training. And how many people been out there or even know that that thing even exists?
And you also pass Hyder.
Yes,
and Hyder is there. And the amazing thing about Hyder is that you see this field of green bottles. There's a field of green. There's I don't know how many thousands upon thousands of green bottles, right? It's overwhelming. And you're looking at them and you're like, and they got one water tower left. And so you drive in there, and I hiked over there and I looked at it, and I picked them up. They were wine bottles. So they were making sure those guys had enough booze.
Yeah, because that's Camp Horn right there. That's the remnants of Horn.
I think it was
right
town. The town, I think, was Hyder.
It is in Hyder.
Camp Horn at Hyder. Yeah.
Right.
We went to that, and the tower's still there. Then we went down to that monument you're talking about. Then if you take a left and you loop back down, you hit the runways, the B bombers.
Yes.
Runway. Yeah.
That's off of Sentinel or something. No. Off of Dateland. You get off of Dateland and you take a right, to your right is the old airfield. And then if you take the service road, you run into all the barracks foundations.
Yeah.
And the crazy thing is, it's on both sides of the freeway. So you would have to somehow get to the other side. But in the middle of the freeway, the freeway runs right through the barracks. Is one side has barracks is the foundation still, and the other side has the foundation still. And I also noticed that if you go to Sentinel and you go up that direction, you can actually get onto the Oatman Road and come in the other side instead of going through where the Painted Rock area is and getting off there. You can get off at Sentinel. You can go not even a mile straight, and to your right is the Oatman Road. And you take the Oatman Road, and it leads you right to the gravesite back there.
Right. Yeah. And so what we did was we stopped at Dateland, got to get a date shake, right?
Wait, hold on 1 second. Do you have videos of the monument and everything?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why have I?
And then I did videos because there's two camps down there at that point where the monument's at. There's two camps. One camp went to Hiroshima after the bomb. One side of that camp in Patton's went there to get control of Japan. The other one went to like the Berlin siege. So both of those camps down there, and I'm trying to think what the names of them are, but both of them were instrumental in World War II. Both of them were right in the middle of the mix, both those guys. And so you take that big loop, and it's intriguing. I mean, it really is. I know someone that went into those houses, and that was like a bar. It was like a commissary. You could tell it was a bar at one time. And then again, when you see those wine bottles, I'm telling you, there's thousands upon thousands upon thousands. The only thing we could figure was, well, you know, these guys might've been there last time. We were going to make sure that they went out happy, you know? And
I find it amazing that it still exists. I find it amazing that those buildings are still standing from around 1943, 1944 in the middle of the desert, made of wood. I think that's intriguing to me. It shows it as a ghost town, which I don't, but it looks like somebody lives.
Yeah. There's somebody some houses right
that
next
people
to
live
them.
There.
Yeah, yeah. And there's signs to say no trespassing, and there's a house next to them that looks like it's now also is the cult that's in that town. If you follow that road. So if you follow that road past those buildings, it'll take you up and over the hill. And then there is a cult down there. Children of the children of
I remember you telling me spoke on the live of that one time.
And then you go to Agua Caliente. That's right there. Then right there is a Pioneer Cemetery on the right-hand side too. And there's also Indian petroglyphs on the left side as well. There's also petroglyphs in Agua Caliente. And if you, I'll show you on Google Earth. Let's
get the video in the queue. Put the video in the queue. I'm going to be doing all of this stuff. And I didn't even know you were out there already.
I don't know. I've got it. I did shorts on them. I'll have to dig them up.
You did YouTube shorts on them?
Yeah. Yeah. The monument. Well,
that's got to be recent, right?
I don't know. We'll have to dig it up. I got them. We did that. And then we did the camp. And then we did Agua Caliente. And then we did the Pioneer Cemetery in Agua Caliente. We did the petroglyphs in that area. Because we made that big loop. Made that loop. Me and James did it once, and me and John did it once. It's two separate trips. Me and John did more of the World War II stuff. And then me and James kind of crossed over into Agua Caliente and some of the historical stuff. But we made that big loop. You get off. There's also a monument at Dateland. It's important to those date palms are also did a video because those are unique. Those were put there because they are the jewels, which are some of the finest dates in the world. And they come, and you have to be kings to eat them. Normal people can't eat those. They came from in the Middle East. They were special date palms that only the elite people could eat. They had a problem and they needed to get some sent to America because they were losing their crops. They had some type of problem. So they put them there because it's real common, the same as where they're originally from. So originally those are the date palms for kings. So isn't that weird?
It is. Did you go to the airfield that was there on the other side of the freight?
On the right hand side. They're not hangars. They're concrete, like where they had gun emplacements, but I'm sure there wasn't gun emplacements.
They say that those are target things, the concrete that's there. It just amazes me because the service station and the store and everything's on the opposite side of the freeway.
Yes.
And those were two of the markers are at.
Yes.
And I'm like, why place them? No, place them. I understand they place them there because they're kept up. But the thing that bothers me most is when I go to service stations and gas stations and rest areas and the markers are there because it's not the original location. It'd be down the road or something, but they put them there because more people will see them, especially who's going to stop and take a, go off to the right and not to the left if you're coming from here on Dateland. Because if you turn to the right where we want to go, where the hangar is and where the thing is, that's just no man's land to most people. You want to go to the left to go to the fueling station and get some food and then get back onto the freeway. But I hate it when those things are sitting at those locations. It's almost like the Air Force Museum here in Mesa. They have like 27 historical markers there because they have to do with the World War II, but they're not at the location of you know where these significant things happened. They're just at that museum because most people will walk by them and see the majority of them.
Now, what's amazing is that if you all the way to Yuma on the right hand side, Patton had troops all over. I don't care any road that you're, and we know it because we were looking for petroglyphs, right? And then you see it squared out. So you see, and it goes all the way to Yuma. So he had stuff going on all the way out there. And also, it's pretty unique that some of this stuff's still there, that it's still standing. I mean, it's incredible that it was still standing but that was a major operation for World War II. I mean, I did a video on all the two camps. One was like Camp Wolfpack and something. I don't even remember. But again, one went to Hiroshima to clean up after the bomb. And then the other was like the Battle of the Bulge. I mean, these guys were in the middle and they got there in the middle of July because they wanted to get them ready for North Africa. So they sent them to the, and you know, most of that stuff was tents and stuff. So, oh, what I was going to tell you, on the way to either, I'm trying to remember if it's on the way to Sears or on the way to Quail Point. There is a place, if you know what to look for, where he had all his tanks. It's Quail. All his tanks were out there, and there's still oil filters to all these tanks that they had. And they used to have a railroad cars where they bring these tanks in and drop them, you know, and take the tanks off the railroad cars and then set them up and do all their maneuvers and training down there for the tanks. And there's still fuel tanks buried in the ground there that was running diesel. And that's still there. I mean, you'll find oil filters all over. It's really incredible. But there's still, but it's right on the right hand when you're going to Quail Point. I believe it's Quail Point. You start seeing how stuff's lined up, and you're like, what? We're in the middle of and you're in the middle of nowhere, right? I mean, it's like, and then you start looking, and then you start realizing, wow, there's a lot of stuff going on out here. It would have been unbelievable one time how many vehicles and how much they had all those bombers flying over, all that area. It would have been an incredible just to see the amount of people down there. Bob said there's supposed to be a Butterfield stagecraft called Happy Camp off 238 Sonoran Desert Preserve between Maricopa and Gila Bend.
I believe that's one that's marked.
So I'm not sure. I believe it though. I mean, you think about all the stage stops. There's a stage stop right down there by the petroglyph hill down there. There's a stage stop still standing. Now it's decaying down by the toll road. So all that stuff would have been rolling through there. That would have been massive amounts of people that you would have seen coming through there, going all the way to California. And then, you know, as that changes, then all of a sudden you have the railroad come through. And then all of a sudden, I mean, that changes. You have all the, you know, patent comes through. I mean, there's so much history down in that area. It's absolutely incredible to me. It is.
Yeah. And here in Queen Creek, just right up the road, you have Desert Well stage stop that was attached to the Florence, going from Florence to Tucson, that still exists on the corner of Chandler Heights and Sossaman Road. And most people, again, when they think of stage stop, they're looking for buildings and stuff like that. That's not what they were. They were wells that could access water, and that the well is still there, 116 feet deep down to get to the water. But they still have that there, and that was a major in the line of all of these stage stops. They have one right here in Queen Creek. This book right here, Arizona Goes to War, I pulled off at an old bookstore. And it has all of like this, all the maps to all those places that we were just talking to. And I love these kind of books. They give you the location to everything. That's where I learned about all those places off of Dateland and Hyde and all that stuff. They actually give you what's there, the history of it, and exactly how to get there off the freeway. So it's a great book.
Well, you know, this time of the year, you know, instead of going outside and roasting completely, you know, you might get out for a little bit. You might go see the Niza signature, regardless, just pretty quick off the trail, right? And you talked about this morning, you know, there's not as many people. You don't have to fight the people. And, you know, if you go early, you can get up there and back, and you can see some petroglyphs. You can see that. It's still a fascinating piece of history. I mean, it really is, whether it's real or not.
Well, think
you
about
can
it.
Take that loop. You know,
what's cool is you can go up to see that signature, and when you're standing up there, you look straight down, and that's where the major petroglyph site is at. I mean, it's within 50 yards of his signature down the hill is that major petroglyph site, and it's the only petroglyphs that are anywhere around that side of the park. You're not going to find any more anywhere else.
Right.
But there's a beautiful, I sent you that picture. There's a beautiful little panel right there that most people, again, they just walk by it, and it's 80 yards from the parking lot are those petroglyphs. And I would say if you looked at those and you climbed up the hill and you looked at the signature in the old lion cage there, you could do all that within 20 minutes and be right back in your car and leave in the park.
That's, you know, South Mountain has a lot of fabulous history. It really does. It really is a, you know, it really has some really cool stuff. And there's, again, there's books out there about all the stuff that's taking place there. And that place is fascinating. Even if you don't go for a long hike, you know, you go for that short hike, like you're talking about, And make that loop to, you go down the 8 and you get, there's so much stuff on the 8. I mean, you make that loop. And again, we've made that loop twice. We've actually even taken the loop, from there to Hyder. We've taken the back road all the way to Gillespie Dam. It will run
to that'd be too far.
No. Sundap and all. And the road's actually nice though. I mean, it's a gravel road, but, and it goes on forever, but it goes all the way to Gillespie Dam. That's how crazy those back roads are. And then you get to Tuberculosis Center there. It still has all the markings on the ground and all that. It's not worth the trip to take it all the way from that place to that place. But we drove it from Gillespie Dam all the way across to come into to Camp Horn, the back way. And it's a long drive, a long drive.
Yeah, I'm just looking at to Camp Horn. What I had to stop doing, though, is doing what I was doing and finding Mohawk and finding those other Stanton Station, because that just makes you. And then there's a B-52 or something was crashed. And if you're coming in from Yuma, the second rest area off of Yuma, if you pull into the side there, it shows it from Google. And somebody actually did a video on it on YouTube. They put up a monument in 1992 out there in the desert to that crash site of the B-52 that went down out there. All kinds of stuff off the side of that road. You gotta be like, either like, all right, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go down one side. I'm going to hit all that stuff. And you got to really be on it and say, I'm going all the way to Yuma and I'm going to get Jack Swilling's gravesite. And then I'm going to turn around and I'm going to go 67 miles back towards home. I'm going to stop at that rest area and get that B-52 crash site. And then I'm going to get back on the road and go back down. I'm also going to stop at Mohawk. And then I'm going to slip over to the, if you wanted to do that, I don't even know if you could do it all in one day. I think if you left at 5 o'clock in the morning, it's possible that all that could be done in one day.
It'd be a long day. Stan, we did a loop one time, from Quartzsite, then down to Yuma and then back that way. And it was a long day, but we saw a lot. There's so much. I mean, again, now you're talking about all the geoglyphs, even on 8, most people don't realize if you get on Google Earth and you look off the side of the road on both sides of the 8, you will start to see geoglyphs that most people didn't probably never been to. I mean, they're not like intriguing. They're not characters. They're circles and things like that, but they're not, they're ancient stuff. And I can tell you that probably most people have never been there. You know, they have no idea. There's also a cool graveyard off of the 8. I'm trying to think what town that is where you take a left, and I'm trying to remember if it's Oatman. Okay. Where you get off at Oatman, that was a train station right there. Now it's this little gas station. I think they're putting a brand new gas station, but right next to it was the train station, the original train station that still stands, even though
it's still there. Closed.
I think, yep. I don't know if the lady let me in there one day or something. I don't remember. She was super yellow. Nice.
And somebody did a, when I was trying to find something on Maricopa Wells, just like 3 days ago, somebody did interesting things off of Interstate 8, got 127,000 views.
That's awesome.
Like, you gotta be kidding me. In one of the places I marked it off on when I was going through Google was that old train depot. They said that they moved that train depot, that the freeway was coming through and other things were coming through. And they actually lifted that thing up and moved that miles down the road and set that where it's at today. Cause it was out in the middle of nothing before, but now it is around a gas station. But yeah, it's one of the oldest standing railroad houses that you're going to find.
Well, that little on the Y exit going down, I'm trying to think which, because they all go to petroglyph sites when you're going down 8 and you take all those rights, whether you're going to Sears or going to Quail or going to Oatman or whatever, it doesn't really matter. They also, the little house there, Y, that's where Buffalo Bill spent time in there, and his name was written on the wall at one time, carved in the wall. And the guy that owned that was the guy that managed his Wild West shows. And so he spent time in that house. So that corral and all that is all original stuff. Somebody got in there and broke that house down and they have killed it. It was cool. I mean, at one time you could see it on the wall, and that was in my early days of searching out Arizona, Sentinel. and El Dorado Hot Springs is in that area. There's so much. It's a cool trip. It really is. There's so much stuff on down. Whether you go down to Tucson, whether you're going down the 8, whether you're going up to 17, there's just so many things to see. There's just so many. If you've done the work and you do the research and you know, I think it's cool. There's a video out on things to do on 8, you know, I think
it's very, cool. Very recent too. And that just lost history. That's all it is people going up and down that thing from Yuma, from Phoenix mostly. I mean, and of course people going across country, but people just pass by that stuff because look, I mean, seriously, if somebody was an investor off of Dateland, they would do something with that. I don't know if there's houses back there. It looks like there was some houses sporadically back by that airport back there. Now I know there's an elementary school up that road on the left,
Yeah.
But I'm like, there's so much. You could have a World War II pull off to Dateland. You can go there. They would get more people stopping there and then going across and checking that stuff out and then going up and seeing that monument. A lot of places, just like Johnny Ringo's gravesite, has little boxes for donations to keep the site up and stuff like that. And you would think that they, I mean, that airfield is spectacular. I mean, it is laid out spectacular on Google Earth. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how many times I went over and didn't see it. And to know that that's sitting right there and the 8 cuts right through it, there's a lot of history out there that people are just missing. There's no signs. There's no historical. Like, Texas does it the best. I was only there for 4.5 months. But, man, Texas has every single spot marked off on the side of the road that there is a historical marker coming. I think on the way home, I saw no more than like 150 of them off the side of the road, meaning that you would have to take a right and go like 15 miles and you'd see it. But it would tell you what road to turn down for historical marker. Arizona sucks at that.
Bob's talking about, I know that there's something about that cemetery, and I'm trying to think, because somebody did a video on it, believe it or not. There is a cemetery down there. It's got something weird to do with it. I'm trying to think what it is, but I don't remember it. I mean, there's so many places in the state to go to that. I mean, I was thinking about, you know, I haven't done my Douglas run and my, you know, across the bottom, because I have to go to the bison kill sites. I mean, I got to go to the woolly mammoth kill sites. I have to go down there. I have to. And so hopefully we can get going on that.
Well, here's the problem. Here's the problem. For the next who knows how many months, they're tearing the crud out of 10. And so they've got 4 miles in Tucson still broken down where you have to go on the frontage road. So when I want to go to Evergreen, it's only 2 miles of it. So it's not a big deal. But it goes a long ways. And then you jump back onto the freeway. And then when you get closer towards Tombstone, which is a terrible place to do it, they've done it again. And you have to get off on the frontage down there and go for miles on the frontage road before it gets back onto the 10. So everything is torn. I mean, from if you were going through both Tucson and all the way down to Tombstone, you probably got to add another almost hour onto your trip. Right. And then you better not be coming back during rush hour, especially through Tucson, if you got to go on frontage road for 2 or 3 miles to get through the town. So they're really giving us a bad thing this summer on the freeways, because it's going to be tough if you want to go to those locations.
I definitely agree with that. I mean, that's the only issue. Tucson has always had a nightmare. I mean, every time they finally get it almost done, they start over. It's like, come on. I mean, why try to kill yourself down there?
Think about it, Jeff. I moved here. It was like 4 or 5 years through the middle there of the 10 going through town that was all jacked up completely. Then within about a year ago, it was clean. Both sides were beautiful. What could they possibly be shutting down both sides of the freeway for every day to fix for about 2 to 2.5 miles? I can't even figure it out. It's all just been fixed and repaved, and it took years for that to happen.
Well, I remember, you know, we were associated with the business I was in with Tucson Harley, and they told them that it was going to be 2 years that they were 2 years on that. And it was 2 years.
Oh, it was.
It seemed like it just got done And now it's back and they're circling.
I moved here in 2012. I probably first time down there was 2013. I do never remember it being completely open and clear until last year when I drove through it. Everything was paved. Both sides were open. All the bridges were done. And you went through and it looked beautiful. And now all of a sudden, within the last 2 weeks, they've closed both areas off in that exact same location for 2 to 2.5 miles. And that is a long ways to go through that town on Frontage Road, because I'm glad they have frontage roads off of there that they can divert you. But there's a lot of lights. And I can imagine during rush hour or in the morning or any other time, if there's an accident, how long it would take you just to get through Tucson, not down there around Benson and Tombstone.
It would be a mess. It would be a nightmare. But I tell you what, that's a lot of stuff that, you know, and here's the thing. I really believe this. I believe that I have not even scratched the surface to the people and the stories that are out there that, you know, I was reading some of these early 1900s papers, and all of a sudden these guys, this sheriff in Maricopa that used to beat that when they had the bum problem, because during prohibition, the prohibition era of the Great Depression, in that window of all the madness going on, and everybody was riding the rails, and you know, the wars they had with bums coming through their towns, and all the stuff that was, it was crazy listening to that and reading these stories. And it talked about these sheriffs that, you know, some of them were dirty as well, but I mean, still, you just don't think about all the things that went on through every layer of history that kept going on, and how, you know, how difficult it would have been doing that. We've been doing Tucson Gym Show since 89, and it's always been messed up. Like, you know,
1989.
Well, that's what happens when you design a town with no circle, right? When you design a town and you don't have a circle,
you don't have another way around it.
There's no way around it. You don't have an option to go. You have to funnel to the mess, right?
Can you do the 79 though? Can you just jump on the 70? I mean, it would be a long ways. It's a long diversion for me that goes through Florence and then cuts into the Hunt Highway. Cause I think you can take that almost all the way from Superior when you jump on the 79, all the way down. And I think also the 177 goes pretty much down to Tucson too. But it's the one that goes to Oracle. That
ride though, Dean, was Tom Mix, and it didn't work out.
That's what I was saying. Oracle when Tom Mix came through there. But that road is that 79. Oh, was that old 80 right there? That is well paid. Well, it's beautiful. It's got a bunch of rest stops to stop and eat. Reminds me of what Texas has, because that's how most Texas roads are. It's just these 2-lane country roads that go for 150 miles, and the rest areas are picnic areas, just out in the middle of the trees. And then you get back in your car and you get, and they're not rest areas to get fuel, but they're rest areas where you can, you know, go find a tree and make it your own and, you know, relieve yourself or whatever, and then get back in the car and move on. But that you're right. There's no 202. There's no 101. There's no 303. There's no other way. Because they closed down the 10 here.
Go right in. You know, one of the worst roads you talk about, you think of Bell's not as bad as it used to be. It used to be one of the worst places that I used to go to run Bell every day at one time in my life, not every day, but 5 days a week. But it Speedway was the same way down there. You know, it was horrible. Speedway. You had to get on Speedway and you were going to just set. Aaron's talking about an old quarry in Gold Canyon, west of Copper Canyon Ranch. I'm not familiar with that quarry, because there's like 5 quarries down in that vicinity that I know of that some of them are still operating. Some of them, there's one that I want to get to that's got a weird thing. We won't even get into that. That's a Saturday show or a Tuesday show. But it's pretty strange. I'm not sure on that one. I'm not sure about it. I did stumble in a pink marble area that's down there. That's a quarry. That was kind of a hand quarry type of deal that has pink marble. I guess that's rare, but I know where it's at. We stumbled into it one day. I said, "You want to see some pink marble?" I said, "I guess." And, walked us back, and we was kind of afraid, but it worked out. It worked out. So, but yeah, I know where it's at. And then my buddy John said, "Oh, that's everybody that's a gem guys know where this is at, I guess. But it's kind of like that bird we saw down in southern Arizona that people are spending $5,000 to see, and we're looking at it all day and it won't leave. And these people are running around trying to find it. And I don't even, you know, I don't even respect it, because I don't know, I have no idea that it's this rare bird that people spend thousands of dollars to see, and it's sitting right in front of us. But I didn't, you know, when you don't know, you don't know, you know, you don't know.
Look, one of the weirdest places I was told, you know, the old Excalibur sword.
Yes.
That one of, when I visited, when I was in Waco, I went to the Red Man Society because it had this unbelievable museum of, like, you know, Cochise, its shoes, all kinds of things that, it was a museum and it was open. I was the only one ever in there. And of course it was a little secret society things. And the guy told me there was another one down the road. It was one of the old lodges, and just tell him that I sent, that he sent me, and I can go in there and check it out. Which was disappointing, because they showed me around and it's not stuff that I wanted to see. I thought they had another museum. But I was told by the gentleman who was leading me around that that sword was in the basement of that place. And he said to me, and I regret it and I don't regret it, but it's like you. He said, do you want to go see it? And I looked at him. And I thought about it, and I said, my wife's out in the car. I can use that as an excuse, because I ain't going down to the deep dungeons of this basement with some dude I don't know in some lodge to go see somebody telling me the mage sword that every I said, how in the world would you have that sword in here? Now, it's one of the oldest ones that there is around that lodge. I mean, it's been there since the beginning of time in Texas. And he's like, well, it's just like anything else. Over time, it got here. It's been down there for as long as I've known and for the long as this lot. And I'm thinking to myself, should have went down. If I would have been packing something on my side of my hip, I would have went down. But I was like, no, you know, my wife's waiting in the car. This place is creepy enough. This is not why I came in here. I just want to get out. But well, man, imagine if it was? And I went down there. That would be a YouTube video right there.
I don't doubt anymore anything really is possible. I mean, look at what you found at the lake, like at Havasu. That's the most bizarre thing ever that was in the church, right? I mean, that is like another level of bizarre. Yeah. I mean, and it's here, right? I mean, so you got to believe that there's a possibility. I mean, you know.
It is a pot. Like I said, if I would have been packing, I would have went down. But I was like,
Yeah, I don't believe it's
pretty big. I ain't going down to the dungeons down there.
Sometimes you just got to make those right calls. Well, man, I think we'll cut it right there at that. And man, it's been a pleasure as always. And I had an awesome time. I hope you guys did too. And I will
check. How can people not have us on a regular podcast? I mean,
yeah, let's do
how
it. Can nobody want to? Somebody's got to get this going.
Come on. We can talk all day long. All right, man. Take care.
He should have went and be like visiting that thing and said, oh, the thing. Yeah, the thing down there. That's so awesome. Oh, man. I tell you, I had a good time. I wanted to do it. Haven't been on. It was like, you know what? Let's just, me and Dean talk like that. We talk. These are conversations we have. This is not like on the air for trying to, there's no entertainment value except entertaining ourselves. And that was awesome. And I appreciate it. And it was kind of fun. That's what we just talk. We talk about these places. You know, he found this book. I had just talked about Maricopa Wells being this man, this place is looking kind of, man, I wonder what it was like when I was doing the research on the Mormon Christmas camp and we found it. And then he stumbles in this book, says, man, this is the place. And I know where it's at. What's funny, I know exactly where it's at. But the history there is phenomenal, unbelievable. So we just got into that. So, and this ain't the music to the outro. I want to thank all the people that came on here, and I want to thank Rock the Crystals for the love and everybody there. I hope you had a good time. It wasn't planned. We just kind of hung out. Thanks for hanging out with us and chatting with us. Thanks for hanging out in the living room. Been awesome. I'll see you guys later. Have a great evening. Adios, amigos. Man, the alien leavings. We'll leave on that note. Adios, amigos. Have a great Sunday. Thank you for hanging out. I appreciate it.